Right. So we're just going to wait briefly while people are logging on. There's still a few people joining. So I can see the numbers ramping up. This is great. So yeah, we seem to have a webinar which is of considerable interest to the mushroom industry, which is terrific. So I think we might just get started. So welcome to today's webinar on mushroom marketing. This webinar is brought to you through the MushroomLink project, funded through Hort Innovation using the Mushroom Levy and matching funds from the Australian Government. Today, Wendy Hubbard, Consumer Insights Manager at Hort Innovation, will be taking us through recent trends in the cost of living and consumer behaviour, and how these factors affect the mushroom industry and indeed the marketing program, which is under development and will occur next year. Wendy is ideally qualified in this area with more than two decades of experience trying to understand the vagaries of consumer trends, their wants, their needs, and what's this month's great trend. Her expertise lies in identifying both the business challenges and the opportunities offered in this changing consumer landscape. A data wizard, armed with qualifications from RMIT, Swinburne University, and Macquarie Uni, she has skills in data visualization, quantum plus brand tracking, and data mining, which sounds most interesting. Wendy's favourite way of eating mushrooms is fried up for breakfast, simply paired with some wilted spinach, hold the toast. There will be time at the end for questions and feedback. We would love to hear your thoughts, ideas, and questions for Wendy on this very amazing data set. Simply write your questions into the chat as we go along and we'll come back to them at the end. And on that note, I'll hand over to Wendy. Welcome. And if you'd like to.
Thanks, Jenny. That was a great intro. All right, let me just see. All right, so as Jenny mentioned, my name's Wendy. I'm the Consumer Insights Manager at Hort, where I've been for the last 12 months. My favourite mushroom, I'm one of the 20% of consumers that eat mushrooms for breakfast, and I just sling them in a pan with some garlic, thyme and pepper. But perhaps more interesting is the mushroom ice cream I ordered recently whilst out dining for my birthday. It was quite yummy, actually. I was like, you've got to be joking. I need to try that. So with with that out of the way, for today's session, we'll be taking a look at the cost of living in Australia, how this is impacting on our shopping behaviours in the retail landscape, and then the mushroom category and how this is performing. Note that I'll be using a variety of data sources, including ABS, some banking data, some Nielsen consumer panel, and our very own consumer tracking data. So the sources are provided at the bottom of the charts. Also note that my role here today is to present you with the facts rather than to be embellishing or providing you with any direct strategic advice. But all of this information has been taken into consideration and is included in the information that for the mushroom marketing SIAP that those plans will be based on. Okay. Sorry, just getting used to my controls here. So before I launch into my comprehensive set of data facts for you, what I wanted to do is just land, I guess, the key kind of points that I'm going to take you through today, and then we'll have a look at the evidence that supports these. So to start off with, cost of living is the top concern for Australians, and inflation combined with cost of housing sees many households struggling to make ends meet, which is resulting in some tough spending choices. With shopping behaviours, what we see is value-seeking behaviours are evident. Consumers are shopping around to get the best deals. They're right-sizing, they're buying private label, and they're shopping at discounters to stretch their grocery money further. In terms of mushroom performance, what we see is actually fewer households are buying mushrooms, and this has been a longer-term trend. With rising prices over the past 3 years, fewer households have bought mushrooms, so demand creation and right-sizing are more important than ever. And then finally, just briefly on mushroom safety. What we've seen is that consumers are not overly concerned about the safety of mushrooms. And sure, there's been some interest in the Leongatha story, but this has not been significantly impacting on mushroom sales, not to say that there aren't some who've been put off, but the majority unaffected. The bigger issue is actually the cost of living. All right, so what we're going to do with the cost of living is just paint you a picture of the economic landscape that we're operating in. It's a really big macro issue, and it's at its worst that it's been in a very long time. And what you're about to see is that the financial well-being of Australians has declined, with some groups feeling it more than others. So it can be really easy for us to make assumptions about everybody else based on our own situation, but it's really important that you, have the view of how other people might be doing it as well, if you're one of the lucky few that are relatively unaffected. There are some groups who are feeling it more than others, and it's particularly those without savings and the 70% of Aussies who don't own their own home outright. So just to start off with, the cost of living blow to household budgets, and as grocery spend rises, 2/3 of people say that price is the most important consideration. And I'm sure all of us have noticed that. But so it's no secret that Australian households are under financial pressure. All right, so moving on to have a look at some of the facts behind that. There's lots of data here. But I think the key sort of takeouts of it really are in the points that I've highlighted on the slide. So on the left-hand slide, what we have is consumer sentiment, and that's the Westpac Banking Melbourne Institute consumer sentiment. And then on the right side, what we've got there is the ABS, who provide an index cost of living trended over time, right? So on the left, consumer sentiment is how consumers are feeling. And you can see from this chart that consumers are not optimistic about their finances, right? And it's not just a bad feeling, right? Because on the right-hand side, what we actually see is that CPI has increased at its highest amount on record, right? So first of all, with that, going back to that sentiment index, what we see is it falling to its worst level since the 2020 COVID pandemic. But actually, if we go back over the last 10 years, that 2020 period and right now are the lowest levels that we've seen consumer sentiment in for the last 10 years. And the RBA's November rate hike has put renewed pressure on family finances and reignited consumers' concerns about the rising cost of living and the prospect of further rates to come. It was lovely that they gave us a little pre-Christmas reprieve, but I think, potentially I'm not the only person that would think this as well. Potentially there's further rate increases to come. So all household types recorded stronger cost of living annual rises compared with the CPI, and this was highest amongst employee households, and that's because of the increase in mortgage interest rates. All right. So I don't want to bore you too much with the economic data, but I guess I just wanted to make sure that you had an understanding of the foundation of that, what is driving people's concerns. So it's not just mortgagees who are feeling the pressure of increased housing costs. Anyone that's got a mortgage, no doubt, will have noticed that they've got less money to spend. But actually, in Australia, there's only 31% of people who own their house outright. We've got 35% with a mortgage, and then we've got 30.6% who are renting. So on the left chart is that one from the ABS, which looks at the cost of living index, and it's showing the increase in mortgage interest rate charges. And you will have seen in September there, that peak, where it increased by 96%, and it's since subsided on the previous year. But in the chart on the right is actually looking at rents and the annual movement in rents. And you can see that 2023 has seen the highest increase in rental prices since 2009. So for those who own their own homes, that's happy days. For the rest of us, the cost of our housing's gone up, but it's not just the cost of housing, right? It's the cost of a lot of other things as well. So it's no great surprise, probably, to you that in total, the financial well-being of Australians has declined. So this is information taken from ANZ, who conduct a financial well-being analysis. And in the year to June 23, we see that financial well-being declined in total. And you can see also here on this chart that some of us are affected more than others. So if you're one of the lucky people who are sitting in the no worries box, and there's fewer and fewer of us, as time goes on, then perhaps you might be wondering what all of this is about. But if you're one of the ones that's sitting in the struggling box, these are the people who are unable to meet their immediate financial commitments, right? And have very little, I guess, ability to meet, upcoming financial needs. So not surprisingly, some of us are better insulated than others, and it really comes back to not only your exposure from a housing perspective, but then also how much money you've been able to save, or how many assets that you have available to you. So not surprisingly, households with savings and who own their own homes feel a pinch less than others. And in the ANZ study, what we see is that financial well-being varies across life stages, not surprisingly, because when we're younger, we tend to have less assets. And as we're older, we've tended to, accumulate some wealth. So we see that young adults, young families are feeling it particularly hard, whereas older families and retirees, people who've got a little bit of savings behind them potentially, and maybe even some investment properties or other investments, are a little bit buffered. That's on the left. And then on the right-hand side, what we've got here is some more ABS information, which is looking at the household savings ratio. And importantly, what we can see is that household savings declined to 3.2 in the June quarter. And that's at its lowest level since the GFC, since June 2008. Additionally, you can see that during COVID, many households were able to increase their household savings, and we've actually used those household savings to buffer us from these rising costs. But what we're also seeing is that those savings have now sort of really been run down, and actually our costs have started to outweigh our income. So our spending is above what we've been earning. All right, so what that means is that many of us are having to cut back because the cost of living crisis is sort of taking hold. And there's these are just a few little snippets that I've taken out of the media. Aussies are now going to extreme lengths to survive the country's increasingly difficult cost of living crisis. And there's a Finder survey, which is also replicated by the Westpac Consumer Sentiment Survey, finding that 40% of consumers are planning to spend less on gifts this year than last year, and actually even 8% of people cancelling their Christmas plans, which is fairly sad, a bit gloomy. We see young Aussies forgoing necessities as the cost of living crisis deepens, and some of them are having to make decisions around, only eating two meals a day, as an example. We see food insecurity is now having a mortgage, a full-time job, a side hustle, and yet food is a discretionary spend in the household budget. And even Vegemite is falling victim to cost of living crisis. There was a recent piece in social media outrage about how it's almost $10 for a jar of Vegemite, and that's labelled as being everyday low price. I'm not sure about you guys, but I have noticed that my local Coles, they've now put in these security gate banner things, much like an airport, so that they can basically stop you from exiting the store. And no doubt this is to combat rising theft as people, are struggling to be able to get the food that they need. It's a bit grim, I guess, for some of us. For others, less grim. All right. So that's painted the overall economic situation. And what I'm going to do now is just move on to how that's impacted on consumer behaviour. All right. Sorry, we went through two there. So Australians have become increasingly cautious with their spending, even those with savings to dip into. And we see non-food retail, so things like furniture, gardening, homeware and electronics has already recorded declines in sales. And this reduction in discretionary spending has allowed Australians to absorb higher prices elsewhere. So for instance, at the checkout, while still sticking to their budgets, but grocery takeaway, so far grocery takeaway and cafe growth has proven resilient with pent up demands post-lockdown still driving some out of home volume. But there was some new information released 2 days ago, actually, where we actually start to see some of those things turning around and coming into decline. So we can see in terms of how people are managing this in their budget, it's probably, you know, the obvious thing. So the first thing they're doing is cutting back on discretionary expenses. So these are things that they, you know, decide are, you know, non-essential, if you like, and everyone's going to have a different view of what's non-essential for them. Sticking to a budget and then seeking out the lowest possible prices that they can. So here what I've got for you is a survey that Nielsen actually put out to their consumers, asking them, you know, what their intended spending change is. So it's really sort of looking at what their outlook is really and where they think they're going to be spending more and where they think they're going to be spending less in the next 12 months. And what you can see from this is that consumers are expecting to spend less on what we might regard as being discretionary things. So things like out-of-home dining, takeaway, clothing and apparel, entertainment, appliances, home improvements, etc., as they're needing to funnel their funds into things like utilities, rental mortgage, groceries, transport costs and the like. And when we look at their their spend intentions when it comes to groceries, we can see a similar pattern here where they think that they're going to need to be spending more just to get the basic things that they require. So things like fresh produce, dry grocery, dairy, frozen meat, and they think that they're going to be spending less on alcoholic beverages, snacks, confectionery, personal and beauty care, and in-store prepared meals. Well, we know in actual fact that that's not necessarily what happens in real life because everyone's got basic human needs that they need to meet. And actually during periods of downturn, you know, we can often see an increase in things like the sales of premium ice cream and chocolate and alcoholic beverages, etc., because we all still need to feel good about ourselves and we all still need to treat ourselves. But what this is telling us is that consumers are looking to meet their basic needs. So FMCG, so this is looking at Australian retail sales released by the ABS as well, and it is labelled quarter four, which I was slightly confused about, but it's quarter four of the financial year, not quarter four of the year. I was like, how could they have these numbers already? We're still in quarter four. So what we see in the quarter two June is that there's a slowing of growth across all sectors, really, except for supermarkets. So we can see, for instance, that cafes and restaurants for the year managed an increase in sales of 35%, but then for the quarter to June, that had slowed back to 14%. And actually, when you look at the spending figures that came out for October, it's, I think, moved into decline. So it's just supermarkets that have still got growth for the quarter ahead of the year. FMCG could be very well positioned to capture shifted demand from other areas. For instance, things like out-of-home dining and takeaways could move into the home. Salon beauty and grooming could also move into the home, and so could socialising and celebrations. All right. So moving on, just to have a look at some of the key things that consumers have been doing, some of the trends that we observe in their grocery behaviours. So there's five key things that I'm going to take you through today. So in terms of how what people's behaviour in the store has been. So what we see is shoppers or consumers, which is us, shopping around to get the best deals, shopping at discounters. We see people increasing their purchasing of private label, also changing pack sizes and adopting healthy lifestyles. But having said that, cost and value is taking precedent over healthy things at the moment. All right, just move this on to the next one. So just to start with, how is total grocery been performing? So what I have here is quite a lot of information that we've received from Nielsen, and most of this data is up to the 8th of October. And what we see for the year is that price is the driver of total grocery growth. So we've got value sales for grocery up by 7.9%, but 7% of that is through actual price increases, and just 0.9% of it is volume growth, which is most likely associated with a little bit of population change. So that's relatively flat, to be honest. And when we look at, well, what are the drivers behind that grocery performance, what we can see is that we've got an increase in trips, so people going to store more often. We've got a little bit of an increase in their average spend per basket, but that is offset by actually buying small baskets, so a decline in volume. Some of that is going to be people actually shopping around. So if you go to two stores and buy half in each store, that's going to give you a smaller basket and more trips. And some of it is actually a post-COVID correction as we move back to our pre-COVID smaller, more frequent shops. Okay. So one of the things that I called out was shopping around. And here what we see is that we've got 75% of households shopping at three or more different retailers each quarter. And there's been, in the most recent quarter up to October, there's been an increase in households shopping across retailers. And that's around going the extra mile to get the best bargains. Okay. So then just moving on to have a look at which retailers are benefiting, or how is each of the different channels performing. So amid this inflationary environment, discounters are outperforming the market, followed by supermarkets. On the left-hand side, what we've got is overall share of sales. And on the right-hand side, what we can see is the sales growth on year ago. So discounters managed to increase their sales by 13% against total grocery of 7.9%, and supermarkets also faring quite well. A quick comment on online. You may have noticed in the last slide, which I was probably supposed to tell you, but I forgot, sorry, is that online we can see actually the growth of online slowing. And in fact, it's slightly, it's lost a little bit of share on the previous year. So I thought it worthwhile just having a really quick look at online. And you might hear, oh, online's down or it's losing share, but I just want you to be aware that online's here to stay, and shopping, omni-shopping as it's called, which is a mixture of shopping in store as well as online, has become a standard behaviour across more than half of the Australian population. So we've got 57% of households who are cross shopping both in online and actual physical stores. And whilst the call out is that that's softened versus year ago, if we go back to March 2020, it's actually significantly higher. So what has happened, and looking at the trend of online and the share of online, it's relatively stable, sitting there at around 11. And you can see it sort of has dropped down from a peak earlier on in that particular chart. But what you don't see is what happened before that, which is pre-COVID, where we had online share sitting at about 4.9. And then we had COVID come along and we had online, you know, increasing as people were like, I can't go out, or I don't want to go out, peaking at 14, and then 14% of sales. And then what we see is kind of, I guess, like a smoothing out and of that. So basically there were people that tried it and have been recruited and have adopted online into their shopping repertoire. Additionally, for some people, online shopping offers an easy way for them to manage budgets, because when you're in the online shopping environment, you can see exactly how much you've spent. You can see exactly what you've got in your basket, and it's so easy just to delete stuff out. And here I've got a lovely little quote that encapsulates that for you, which is that online shopping is a brilliant way to make sure you get savers and stick to a budget. You can see when you've gone a bit loose and rein your spending back. So it's definitely here to stay. But when it comes to the actual retailers, probably no great surprise to you that Aldi growth continues to outpace major retailers on the market. And this is primarily through more shoppers giving Aldi a go. So on the left-hand side, what we've got there is the retailers' share of grocery sales. And you can see Woolies there at 39%, followed by Coles. And then I think, what have we got there? Non-supermarkets would be in at third with 11%, followed by Aldi, right, at 9%. But on the right-hand side, we can see Aldi managing to achieve 15% sales growth, and that is predominantly through an increase in the households shopping at Aldi. So we saw earlier that there was an increase in people shopping across three retailers, and Aldi have been a beneficiary of some of that. Okay. Let's see, just move on to the next slide for you. So I did talk about how consumers were shopping around more. And what this chart here shows, sorry, I'm so used to looking at it, I could just easily rush through it, but it is probably a little bit foreign. What this chart here shows is growth and decline through some of the key elements. So we've got units being a detractor, and then above the line we've got things that are adding growth, right? So you can see the buying households in turquoise, and how overall there's not really any new buying households in FMCG, but Aldi have benefited from an increase in people going to their stores, as have Costco and other supermarkets. And when we delve into that, Aldi and who is it, the gain in shoppers was led primarily with households with primary aged children, so with an eldest child who's under 12. It's actually, the penetration gains were strongest with families of primary aged kids. And whilst we have 69% of Aussie household shopping in Aldi, amongst those households at 76.9, and that is actually their highest penetration across all life stage groups, and it has moved up significantly from last year. Right. Just very briefly, because it's probably not super relevant to you, but it is a trend that we see, private label share hitting record high. So 99% of Australian households are buying private label, and private label has actually been outperforming branded products with sales growth of 16.1% versus branded products growth of 7.4%. The average household buying 100 private label items over a quarter. So I'll move on to our next behaviour of right sizing. So right sizing is about buying the right size for you, right? And when you ask consumers how would they prefer for a manufacturer to handle an increase in raw material costs, on the left-hand side, what we see is they say, oh, we'd like some economy value packs. And their least preferred option is smaller pack sizes and downsizing. But in actual fact, what we see happening and playing out is that 52% of categories are growing volume ahead of units. So that is in that economy value pack play. So 48% are not. So 48%, we've actually got downsizing, we've got units growing ahead of volume. So this is, and the reason for this is because households are picking the right size for their needs. So what we've got here is just milk, and it's a really good example of that, where we see that the 2-litre chilled milk pack segment, if you like, has declined. And the reason that it's declined is that you've got people switching into either 1 litre, so downsizing, or you've got people switching into 3 litres, so upsizing, right? And reducing waste is the second most common behaviour that Australians use to live sustainability, but it's also sustainably, but it's also a way of saving, right? Because if you can bulk buy, you get it for a lower price. But if you're buying products that you don't need and you end up throwing out, that's obviously a waste of money. When we have a look at that, I did pull out a quick little one for you on mushrooms. So one size doesn't fit all occasions. And for mushrooms, I don't have a perfect data set for this. What I'm looking at here is just the packaged mushrooms through Nielsen home scan data. So it doesn't include loose mushrooms at all. It's just the packaged one. And what you can see is on the right-hand side, this is a summary of shifting. What you can see is that we've got consumers switching from the smaller pack size into the medium size, so the 251 to 500 gram pack size. We've got people shifting from that pack size up into the 500 to 1 kilo. And then we've got some people shifting from the larger pack size down into the smaller pack size, right? So this is, mushroom buyers are choosing the pack size to meet their needs, and that could be a volume need. So moving to a larger, lower cost per kilo pack, or it could be a cheaper pack and less wastage. So it could be moving to a smaller price point. And then finally, the other trend that I spoke about was healthy lifestyles. So health is still a priority, but the cost of living is limiting growth. So when we ask people what their top concerns are, the economy, inflation. You can see physical health is up there as number 3, house prices increasing, and then mental health. So that's also around health and well-being, right? But for the time being, health and sustainability or environment probably takes us a bit of a backseat to you know, being able to meet my basic financial commitments and requirements. But when we do speak to consumers around, well, what are the things that would drive you to actually pay more for something and switch from an existing product into something new? And there were 59 different statements that they had. Amongst those, the top ones, it's all around health and nutrition. So things like being made with real ingredients, being made with natural ingredients, providing a balance of taste and health. So they're still very relevant product benefits. They're just limited by people's budgets right now. All right, so that's the end of the second section. And now I'm going to move on to mushroom performance, which is the final section of today's session, where what I've gathered for you today are the key facts on performance. We spent many days and hours poring over mushrooms' performance, believe me, and distilled it into some key findings. So you're not going to have everything here, but what you are going to have is what those key findings are. There was a broader analysis that's been conducted, and that's been prepared as input into the marketing strategy development that'll be worked on with the mushroom marketing SIA. All right. So I think, you know, this is just a summary of what you're about to see, really. The first thing that's really important to note amongst all this doom and gloom is that mushrooms are a popular choice amongst Australian households. So don't forget that, right? We've got 76% of people buying it in a year, and there are many categories that would be envious of having that many buyers, right? But more recently, what we see is that retail sales have declined, and that's against rising prices in a cost of living crisis. We can see there's fewer households purchasing, and this is especially families with primary school aged children. No great surprise, given that we know that these are some of the households that have been hit the hardest. So in terms of a performance summary, we've got price of Price per kilo for mushrooms increasing by 3.6% for the year, whilst volume declined 6.2% and value declined at 2.8%. We've got 76% of households buying in the year, which is softer than the year before, so it was 2.6 points higher. We'll see that families with school kids lead that decline. And I think the real, you know, the key sort of opportunity here, or the key thing to sort of be focused on, is really maintaining relevance and giving people a reason to put mushrooms in their basket. Because what you've got here is a situation where people are having to make decisions about what's discretionary and what's non-discretionary. So you want mushrooms to be non-discretionary rather than discretionary. Before we get into any of the facts that support those key findings for you, I just wanted to share this with you because it's come up numerous times when people have spoken to me about mushrooms around seasonality, okay? So I just wanted to share this with you. It doesn't really fit with the rest of the story, but what we see is that there is a seasonal dip over Christmas and New Year. It's just for the 4 weeks ending basically New Year's Day or thereabouts, so it's over December, and this is driven by a drop in household penetration, which is the key driver or indicator of volume. So and look, part of the reason for this is that we're embracing our Christmas repertoire. You know, Christmas is hotly contested by many categories, including seafood, tropical fruits, seasonal delights, turkey, and you could spend, I guess, those types of categories do their livelihood relies on that 1 month of the year. Retailers are looking to compete against, like to pitch against each other for baskets, for Christmas baskets. And so, yeah, it's a difficult time, I guess, for everyday products to sort of stand out. I don't mean that in a bad way. All right, so just focusing back in on mushrooms performance, we'll just start with, you know, what's happened from a sales perspective. And what we see is that retail sales have softened on the previous year, leading to lower volume against rising price. So when we look at value sales, we already, you know, I mentioned that they declined by 2.8, which is a little bit higher than what we saw in the previous year, where they were relatively flat, just slightly down by 0.7. But that was against a volume change of 9.2%. And then in the most recent year, we see that volume down 6.2%. So, part of the reason why we see the value decline is because the increase in price hasn't been large enough to offset the decline in volumes, which was happening previously. We saw this delicate balance between declining volumes but at a higher price, right? And that balance has sort of been upset. I'm going to show you a trend of how that looks, because this is not, it's not a new thing. It's sort of been happening for a little while. The chart on the top shows a volume trend, and the little dotted line shows what that volume looked like at exactly the same time the year before. And then the lower chart shows a value trend, so sales in dollars, and what that looks like for the same time and the year before. And then I've just put what the annual percent change was in the little box there. So we did have declining volume for mushrooms, and that had been going on for a while. But the increase in price of 9.3% against that volume decline of 9.2 was basically kind of cancelling it out from a value sales perspective, right? But then more recently, what we've seen is that overall price increases have slowed to 3.6, and it's been insufficient to be able to offset that volume decline. All right. And I think just to give it a little bit of context for you, just looking at overall these are quarters, and I've just got in here average price of vegetables versus the average price of mushrooms. So mushrooms are one of the more premium, if you like, or more expensive vegetables available, if you could call a vegetable. I know that's contentious. Sorry about that. What we see when we look at the context, which is where, which is vegetables, because that's where mushrooms sit in the supermarket, is that the price for vegetables peaked towards the end of 2022, and it's declined for the past four quarters, right? So we did have some significant price rises, and then it's come back down. But when we look at mushrooms, what we see is that price growth has definitely slowed down, but we do still have eight successive quarters of price increase versus the previous year. And I guess that for some people has made mushrooms, you know, maybe a little bit too premium for them to be able to afford. Just to put it into some context with other products in the supermarket, the average price per kilo for veggies declined 7% to $5.26 for the year up to the 5th of November. And when we have a look just across the page, I've got a bunch of categories there. You can see that the trend is that across most categories, there's been a significant price decline, but that's not been the case for mushrooms. And so what this does, similar to what we looked at previously, is it just sort of breaks down, well, what's happened, what are the components of that growth? And what we can see here is that for mushrooms, the decline that we see is driven through fewer households buying and also lower volumes per occasion. I'm being given the wrap up, so I'm going to just hurry up a little bit. I wanted to raise with you the safety of mushrooms, or the mushroom poisoning, as you know, something that's maybe causing a decline in mushroom volumes. And it's not to say that there isn't a small amount, but that's not the key reason that we're seeing mushroom sales softening. When we ask consumers, you know, what are the barriers? So why are they not buying mushrooms? What they tell us is that they're too expensive. And then the next biggest things amongst, I guess, infrequent, so people who don't buy often, haven't bought in the last 2 or 3 months, is that they didn't think of it, or that not enough people in the household like them, or they don't like the texture. When we speak to people who never buy them, so they're, I guess, objectors, the top reasons are that they don't like the taste or texture, so it's more of a sensory barrier, right? So you're going to struggle to get those people. And when we look up, in the options that we gave them, we did have in there that they don't feel that they're safe to eat. So none of the lapsed or infrequent buyers chose that as a reason that they're not buying mushrooms, not one. And then amongst the people who never buy mushrooms, so they're not really in the category anyway, there was just 6% that said they don't feel they're safe to eat. So there were a whole bunch of other things that come in front of that. So I just wanted to put that out there. Because when you do look at a trend for mushrooms, what you can see is that more recently there has been, I guess, a slight departure from our usual sort of overall trend, and in that we can see penetration dipping down a little bit over the last few periods, and that would happen to coincide with mushroom poisoning, but it also coincides with increased cost of living pressures. And the other pieces of data that we have all point to increased cost of living pressures being the reason that people are not buying mushrooms. We can see when we look at this, which is price charted against penetration, that there is a relationship between price and penetration, and that as price goes up, we've seen a decline in people buying. You could also see that seasonal dip there that happens over Christmas. Okay, next. So there is, this is from our consumer tracking program, where we ask 800 consumers every month about their fruit and vegetable purchasing. And one of the general statements that we ask them is around, you know, value for money is one of the more important factors when grocery shopping. This is the percentage of people who are agreeing with that statement. And you can see how there's been an increase in that over the last few months, right? So increasing pressure on household budgets makes value for money even more critical than what it typically is for Australians. And then when we have a look at these are different life stages, and what I've got here for you is what they're, how much of the mushroom sales they make up. So the overall amount of volume that each of these different life cycle groups purchased over the year. So we've got small scale families, which are households with an oldest child under 12, and bustling families, which is like high school age children, accounting for 23% of mushroom volume. But when we have a look at together, when we have a look at what proportion of the decline in mushroom sales is coming from each of these groups, we see that those two groups are making up 50% of the mushroom decline. So we would expect it to be like relatively even, but actually these two groups are punching above their weight when it comes to reducing the amount of mushrooms that they're buying. Right. And we know that these are the groups that are really struggling or that are finding cost of living a challenge. Awesome. So we're almost at the end now. I just wanted to share with you, I guess, a couple of other key pieces of information. So when we ask our consumers, you know, what are the associations, what are the key benefits of mushrooms? The key benefits that they tell us are that they're easy to cook, that they're healthy, that they're easy to eat, they're delicious, and they're versatile. And these are all endearing features. And we saw that they were important and hold value to consumers earlier on in the presentation. Additionally, though, mushrooms are also perceived as being expensive and premium, unique, exotic, and less of a household staple than other veg. So that is possibly some of the, it's a really good thing to keep in mind that we've got only 30% of mushroom consumers describing them as being a household staple. So that's 70% that aren't. So then when you start to think about people making decisions around discretionary and non-discretionary spending, you can see why they might have been leaving mushrooms out of their basket. And then when we ask them about barriers and why they haven't been buying mushrooms, this is over in our tracker. For many, mushrooms are not a necessity, and so they are liable to be dropped from the basket. So the key reason that people give us for not buying it is because they didn't need them. Not enough people in my house like them, that they're too expensive, or that I didn't think of them, right? So just to wrap up, and just to sort of like go through, you know, the key things or the key pieces of information that we've seen is that mushrooms are a popular choice amongst Australian households. We've seen a decline in sales against or in an environment of rising prices with a cost of living crisis. It's families with school kids that are leading that decline, and these are the households that are like most impacted and least insulated against cost of living increases. And so for mushrooms, maintaining relevance is key. Giving people a reason to put them in their baskets is really important more than ever. And then overall, I'd like to thank you for coming along today, first of all, and just, you know, as we kicked off the session, just to remind you of the key kind of things to take away from this is that the cost of living is a top concern for Australians, that we've seen in shopping behaviours, value-seeking behaviours. Overall, we've spoken about mushroom performance and how we've seen that sort of softening against rising prices. So demand creation and right-sizing are more important than ever. And then in terms of next steps, there's a marketing plan that will be shared via webinar in February, and all of the facts that have been looked at have been, I guess, all of the facts that have been considered in the development of the marketing plan, and that's to be endorsed by the SIAP next week, and then that industry webinar will be, is planned for February. So thank you very much for your attention. I'd like to open it up to Q&A now. So I'm going to maybe just stop sharing my screen because I can't see anyone. I'm presenting into a void. So I'll just stop sharing my screen. And thank you. And I'll just open it up to questions if anyone had any.
Thanks, Wendy. That was great. That's so much information in there. There's so much data. I can see why you are the data wizard. It's a lot to get your head around.
It was really hard deciding what to put in and what to leave out, to be honest, because there is so much.
Yeah. So I can see Nick has asked whether mushroom sales during the Lee and Garther issue are an aggregate metric, so the total mushroom sales button and gourmet both included in this data.
Okay, so I'm not 100% sure what you mean by gourmet, whether that you mean just like including like, say, brown mushroom, like Swiss brown and portobello, or whether you're talking more around exotics. But the data that we have comes from Nielsen Homescan, and so it would be it does break out button, carp, so agaricus mushrooms. And I think they probably would be picking up other mushrooms which are relatively small.
So you're not sure if they really record them as an exotic mushroom category?
Yeah, I'd have to have a look. It wouldn't be split out separately because it would be so small.
Yeah. And I'd suspect that people would often buy those kind of products from specialist greengrocers, which may not be picked up on that data.
Potentially. I don't know if you've seen the price of them either, but like, it's only for the wealthy. I'm not sure if everyone could see the questions or not, so I'll just read them out. So in the monthly tracking, we mentioned that 66% of consumers see mushrooms as healthy. Was this growing in comparison to last month? Okay, so the data that I put in there is not just for the 1 month. It would be, I think it was for a quarter, actually. And typically we see these things to be pretty stable. They don't move a lot, but I could definitely have a look. Off the top of my head, I couldn't tell you. I could definitely have a look to see whether there's any change, but typically they're relatively stable. People's overall perceptions of a category don't tend to wildly shift around.
So that is actually, I think, slightly higher than the average for vegetables as a whole, I think, based on what you had. It was mushrooms were healthier in a way than average vegetables.
Yeah, that would be
a little bit.
Let me just go back to that chart. Healthy, it's an over-index, absolutely. So they would be, and I guess like when we talk about other vegetables, there's things like potatoes in there, which people don't perceive necessarily as being healthy.
Arguably, but
yeah, it might be all the butter they put on them. Who knows?
Yes, well, exactly. So
got any other questions?
Just to reiterate, so how does this data feed into the marketing strategy? So I understand there's going to be a PSYOP next week. Is that right?
Yep.
So will this data will be available to the PSYOP and help in their deciding on the best strategies for next year?
So a comprehensive data analysis went into the workshop, which was preceded the marketing PSYOP meeting that will happen next week. And that was what was used, I guess, as a foundation in terms of developing the marketing strategy. And a lot of the charts that I've shown you were born from that original category overview and deep kind of analysis. Well, I've updated them because some of them were sort of only until like September, because this has been going on for a while, August, September. So I've updated some of them, and I've also found a few other additional pieces of information that were specific to the topic. But absolutely that information was available to the SIA. We've got a question. What are the mushroom sales trend over time for the entire year? Is this reproducible for each year? Okay. So when we looked, there were a couple of charts in there that had that in there. The first one was the seasonality one, which was actually just an index. And it does follow a fairly predictable sort of pattern. There is a slight increase in sales over the cooler months, so sort of like August around there. And then there is that obvious dip over Christmas. And then there was a chart that I showed that had trended price versus penetration. You could use that really as a as an indication of what's happening to sales. So, but I'm just now thinking the second chart that I showed in the third section where we had volume and value trended over time.
I think generally your graphs were showing that sales were declining, so just gradually at a fairly constant rate over time.
So for volume, the gap is bigger than what it has been for value, because part of the value sales were being propped up, if you like, by increasing prices. But it's obviously just reached that point where people are, you know, having to make difficult decisions about how they spend their money.
Yeah.
To be honest.
Yep. So I can see that Leah Bramage from AMGA has put a message into the Q&A. And she says, firstly, I'd like to thank Hort Innovation for this presentation. This was excellent, exactly what the industry have been asking for. Congratulations. So well done, Wendy.
Thank you.
Secondly, this looks all gloom and doom, but before the growers set fire their growing rooms and jump out the window, let's stay focused on the positives. Our mushroom lovers, our high mushroom users, is still buying and still afford to buy. And I mean, as she says also, the ANZ figures show 60% of Aussies are still doing okay or not bothered. So
that's exactly right. That's exactly right. It's not doom and gloom for everyone. 100%. Exactly. 100%. Yeah. And you do still have like more than 3/4 of Australian households are buying mushrooms in a year, right? So people are still buying them. They're just, I think it's more important than ever to give them the ability to buy a smaller price point allocated pack size. So that might be loose mushrooms, right, where they can choose exactly how much they want, but also give them a reason to buy mushrooms, give them an opportunity, a way that they can see how they can stretch their money further. So that might be around, well, instead of comparing us to, like, you could make a meal like a mushroom risotto to feed your family, which would be a lot cheaper than, say, for instance, a spaghetti bolognese, right?
Yeah, exactly. I think, yeah. You know, maybe that's the sort of thing that the marketing, you know, it's up to the SIOP, obviously, yeah. But they might decide, like, feed your family for under $10 by making mushroom risotto
I haven't sat and done all the work around, you know, the planning and the tactics and stuff, but it's around leaning into your strengths and going, well, what are our strengths and what is the situation? What is it that people are looking for, right? They're looking for healthy things, but they're also looking to make sure that they can feed their families, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And retailers are aware of that. You will have seen them, you know, communicating that out into the industry recently. Woolies sent an email to all of their everyday reward card holders talking about it. And you'll see, you'll see them all calling out, you know, how there's lots of savings at their stores.
Yeah, sure. So, and I think, and Leah's also commented that the new marketing SIOP are going to focus on increasing the 4-week penetration of our mushroom lovers. So, yes, it's working with those people who aren't so much in a cost of living crisis and who are able to buy mushrooms and hopefully can buy more.
I think it's around, you know, making sure, like, giving people a reason to buy them. So if you can switch it from being, like a discretionary to a non-discretionary item, obviously during these types of periods, that would be beneficial.
Okay. Do we have any last questions? Because I can see we're just about out of time. But and any other comments from yourself, Wendy?
No, thank you for having me.
Okay. No, that was great. That was really, good. No, it was excellent. Thank you, Wendy. There's a lot of there's just so much data, isn't there? And there's so many ways of looking at that data and interpreting that data. So I think you've tried to bring a very large information into something which can be talked through in 40 minutes. Is quite something. So thank you very much for that. And thanks to Hort Innovation for putting this information together for us. Of course, this webinar has been recorded and it will be available online through the MushroomLink website. And thanks to Hort Innovation for funding the Mushroom Link project, which has made this possible. So thank you, Wendy. And we might leave that there. Thank you all.
Bye. Thanks for attending.